Hello students, in my today's lecture we are going to do the second chapter of this book First Flight, and today's chapter is Nelson Mandela, A Long Walk to Freedom. This is an extract from his autobiography, Long Walk to Freedom. Nelson Mandela, as you know, was the first elected black president of South Africa. He won the democratic elections in 1994 and then he became the black president of South Africa. Students, in this chapter there are few terms and terminologies which are very important. You must know, very important to start with the chapter first, we are going to discuss about this word. This word is apartheid. Okay, now this apartheid, this word means, students, that is a government which discriminates on the basis of color. Okay, and South Africa was a country where the whites ruled over black. There was a strong discrimination between the blacks and the whites. So apartheid is a political system that separates people according to their race, and this race is none other than blacks and whites. So in this chapter, student, this is basically a little historical kind of chapter. In this there are a few dates. There is basically only one date which is there in this chapter which is very important, and that is 10th May 1994. This 10th May 1994 is called as Norton Day. That's a question also comes on this, why is this day called as Norton Day? This day is called in autumn because South Africa is in the southern hemisphere, and hence it is called as an autumn day, because you very well know, like, the countries of southern hemisphere have just reversed the seasons. Like, when we in northern hemisphere we have summers, they have winters, southern hemisphere has winters. Hence 10th May is called as an autumn. So to start with the chapter, students, we are the Nelson Mandela. In this extract of his autobiography, what he is doing is, he is describing, number one, the day of his swearing-in ceremony, the oath-taking ceremony, that is 10th May. Then he is reflecting a little bit in his history. Then he is giving a speech. And when he is giving a speech, he is telling about the promises. He is telling about what his government is going to do and what South Africa will be to the international gathering. Then we find that he is describing about the pomp and show, the military show, which was held on 10th May. Then he is reflecting a little bit in the history. He is thanking the people, those who sacrificed their life for the cause of freedom in the struggle movement. Then he is mentioning about the six great leaders who played a very important role in this freedom struggle of apartheid movement. Then we find, student, that he is describing about the two national anthems of South Africa, a very prominent thing. Then we find that he is talking about freedom. And then we find there is a word called twin obligation towards the later part of the story or this extract. And then lastly we find he is describing about two words. One is oppressed and the other one is oppressor. So let's start with the chapter. Let's begin with the chapter, students. I will read out the chapter and then we will see what difficulties or what explanation is required. 10th May dawned bright and clear. For the past few days, I had been pleasantly besieged by dignitaries and the world leaders who were coming to pay their respect before the inauguration. The inauguration, students, he is referring to the swearing-in ceremony as the first black president of South Africa. The inauguration would be largest gathering ever of international leaders on South African soil. So definitely, as South Africa is a free country now, and Nelson Mandela was elected as the first black president of South Africa, and then we find that to celebrate or to be a part of this occasion, the leaders, the dignitaries from across the world, it was nearly 140 countries, more than 140 countries, those who had come to attend this ceremony. The ceremonies took place, this is very important, so please pay attention to it. The ceremonies took place in the lovely sandstone amphitheatre formed by Union Buildings in Pretoria. So there was an amphitheatre which was made up of sandstone, and this entire process of oath-taking ceremony and the function were held in this amphitheatre. Now, this amphitheatre is in Pretoria, it's a place in Africa. Now here, you know, this immediately after this, when he mentions in this extract, Nelson Mandela says that this particular building, this amphitheatre, was, before he became the president, was the epitome, or was the, not epitome, we can say, it was the center. It was the center of white supremacy. And now, it was the site of a rainbow gathering of different colors and nations for the installation of South Africans first democratic non-racial government. So the same place which was dominated or ruled by the South African white government, now it was a seat for the elected government of South Africa, and he definitely was going to be sworn in as the president of South Africa. On that lovely day, autumn day, I told you why is it called autumn, because it is in Southern Hemisphere, I was accompanied by my daughter Zenani on the podium. Mr. De Klerk, who was the first sworn in as the second deputy president, followed by Thabo Mbeki, who was sworn in as the second deputy, first deputy president. And then I pledged to obey and uphold the constitution and to devote myself to the well-being of the republic and its people. To the assembled guests and the watching world, I say. So students, he was accompanied by his daughter Zenani. And during this occasion, the first oath was taken by second deputy president, and his name was Mr. De Klerk, followed by Mr. Thabo Mbeki, who was the first deputy president. After him, like since in India also we have the president, we have the deputy president, sorry, not deputy president, vice president. Similarly, in South Africa, they have got the president, they have got the first deputy president, followed by the second deputy president. So the oath-taking ceremony was for the second deputy president first, Mr. De Klerk, and then it was the first deputy president, who was Mr. Thabo Mbeki, and then followed by Nelson Mandela. As the ceremony goes, as the ritual goes, so Nelson Mandela also had an address speech. His address to the August gathering, to the international gathering, as well as to the people of South Africa. So I read his speech to you, so you must listen carefully. There are a few phrases in this which is very important. Let's see what he says. Today, all of us do by our presence here confer glory and hope to endeavor to newborn liberty. Newborn liberty is none other than South Africa. Out of the experience of an extraordinary human disaster. Extraordinary human disaster, we are talking about the slavery which South Africa had undergone, and it was through this nearly for three centuries. That lasted too long. Must be born a society of which all humanity will be proud. So he says out of the slave country is born a free country of which everyone will be proud of. We who were outlaws, we are talking about the blacks, who were the outlaws means they were considered to be outlaws, not so long ago have today been given the rare privilege to be host to the nations of the world on our soil. We thank all our distinguished international guests for having come to take possessions with the people of our country of what is after all a common victory for justice, for peace and for human dignity. Sorry. So he says that students, he has fought, he and his race and his people have fought for what? For victory, for justice, peace and human dignity. Then he further says, we have at last achieved our political emancipation. This is nothing other but freedom from slavery. We pledge ourselves to liberate our people from the continent. This you need to pay attention, students, because this is what he is promising to the people of South Africa. So what is his promise? His promise is that he will work to liberate all people from continuing bondage of poverty, deprivation, suffering, gender and other discrimination. So he promised that his people will be free from poverty, deprivation, suffering, gender and any sort of discrimination. He further says, never again shall it be that this beautiful land will again experience the oppression of one race by So he further says that it will never happen in history again that South Africa will ever become the slave of anyone. The sun shall never set on so glorious a human achievement. So very nicely he says that the sun is not going to set on the soil of or on the country that is South Africa. Let freedom reign. God bless Africa. So lastly he says, let freedom be all round and God bless Africa. Students, based on whatever we have done now, there are a few questions. I'll read out the questions, students. You need to do these questions. Question number one, where did the ceremonies take place? Can you name any public building in India that are made of sandstone? Question number two, can you say how 10th May is an autumn day in South Africa? Question number three, at the beginning of the speech, Mandela mentions an extraordinary human disaster. What does he mean by this? What is the second part of the question is, what is the glorious human achievement? he speaks of at the end. Let me tell you about these special students. The extraordinary human disaster is the slavery, that is the rule of whites over black, and the glorious human achievement is the freedom from the racial discrimination and freedom against white. Then next question, question number 4. What does Mandela thank the international leaders for? Very simple. He is thanking the international leaders for attending this ceremony and being a part of his oath-taking ceremony. Then question number 5. What ideals does he set out for the future of South Africa? That is nothing but he promised his people that there will be liberty, or he is going to free all his citizens from the bondage of poverty, deprivation, sufferings, gender and any sort of discrimination. Now we will continue further with the chapter. So now the next part of the chapter, students, as I had told you before also, he is describing that particular day, that which day, that is your 10th May 1994. On this day there was a big military show. I request you all to imagine the 26th Republic Day Parade of India at Jankar. You can very well understand the way the pomp and show is exhibited there. The same way we find that the military of South Africa was also exhibiting that, and it was also very important because they were showing their loyalty to the newly elected president and the government. Let's read. A few moments later, we all lifted our eyes. Who lifted the eyes? The people, those who were present at the amphitheater, in awe, surprise, as a spectacular array of South African jets, helicopters and two carriers rode in the perfect formation over the Union Building. It was not only a display of pinpoint precision and military force, but a demonstration of the military's loyalty to democracy, to a new government that had been freely and fairly elected only moments before the highest generals of South African Defence Force and Police. Their chests, bedecked with ribbons and medals from days gone by, saluted me and pledged their loyalty. I was not unmindful of the fact that not so many years before they would not have saluted but arrested me. Finally, a chevron of Impala jets left a smoke trail of the black, red, green, blue and gold of the South African flag. Now here, students, you need to know, or you need to understand that there was a military show, and this military generals, the police officials, the high ranking officials, they all were standing and saluting the African president, Mr. Nelson Mandela. Now their chest, they all were in uniform, their chest was bedecked or decorated with the medals, the ribbons, the other decorations, whatever they must have received during the bygone days, during the rule of the whites. Now he is telling that all these people, those who were lined up and they were saluting him, they were paying their respect, they were bowing before him, and it was all to show their loyalty to Mr. Nelson Mandela and as well as to Africa, which is a new country, which is a new free country. Okay. So then he says, then he remembers that, he just remembers little bit things of the past. He says, these were the same officials and these were the same people who had arrested him and who had put him behind the bars, that is in the jails, and not only that, they had even tortured him also. And the same people are there today who are saluting him. And why are they saluting him? Because today, Mr. Nelson Mandela is the elected president of the free South Africa. Then they find the Impala jets, they are making a V-shaped structure, that's a V-shaped structure, just and as they fly by, they create a smoke trail, and the colors of this smoke trail is black, red, green, blue and gold, which is the colors of the South African flag. Now let's proceed further. Now the same day, what happens, we find that there are two national anthems sung. Okay, so the day was symbolized for me by playing of our two national anthems, and the vision of the white singing Nkosi's Kelele Afrika and the black singing Die Stem. So Nkosi's Kelele Afrika, students, means God Bless Africa. This was a national anthem which was sung by the whites. When the whites ruled South Africa, this was a national anthem which was sung by the whites, and blacks did not like this. And the blacks, on the other hand, sung another national anthem which was called Die Stem. The meaning of this Die Stem is the voice of South Africa, the call of Africa, and the whites did not like this. So both the whites hated Die Stem, and the blacks hated Nkosi's Kelele Afrika. at, but that particular day, that is on 10th May 1994, what happened, that both of these national anthems were sung. Though both the parties, the white and the blacks, did not understand the lyrics of either of their national anthem, but both of them sang. And the question comes over here, very important question comes. First of all, the question comes, name the two national anthems. And then the question comes, why were the two national anthems sung in South Africa? The two national anthems were sung in South Africa, students, because he had promised in his speech, who? Nelson Mandela had promised in his speech that in his land, in his South Africa, free South Africa, there will be no discrimination based on color. Hence, he has taken that the whites, those who were there in South Africa, are also the citizens of South Africa, though they are no longer the rulers, but they will also enjoy all the rights which the blacks will be enjoying, that there will be no discrimination as far as rights are concerned in South Africa. Let's proceed further. On the day of inauguration, I was overwhelmed with a sense of history. Overwhelmed with a sense of history means it's a great moment, it's a proud moment, it's a very happy moment. So he is just reflecting few things from the history. In the first decade of 20th century, a few years after the bitter Anglo-Boer War, before my own birth, the white-skinned people of South Africa patched up their differences and erected a system of racial domination against the black-skinned people of their own land. The structure they created formed the basis of one of the harshest, most inhuman societies the world has ever known. Now, in the last decade of 20th century, my own eight decade means it was 80 years, that system has been removed. The system has been overturned forever and replaced by one that recognized the rights and freedom of all people, regardless of the color of their skin. So he is reflecting that in the earlier part of 20th century, that we are talking about 1901 to 1920, this first early years of 20th century, what happened, that all these European people who had come to South Africa, because South Africa was a rich country known for its diamonds and gold, so all these Europeans, basically the white people, they dissolved their differences, they patched up, they formed a group, and then they started ruling the other part, other group, that is your black people. And that is how the rules of white was established. And that is how the blacks of South Africa were no longer treated as human beings. Then he says, in the last part of this last decade of the 20th century, everything was turned and South Africa was able to win over this freedom struggle, and it's a free country now, and there will be no racial discrimination. Then on this particular day, what is happening in the next paragraph, we find that he is remembering all those people, those who have sacrificed their life during the course of freedom struggle and have lost their life. Those who are not alive today to see this beautiful day, to see the reward of their hardships. Okay, let's read it. That day had come about through the unimaginable sacrifices of thousands of my people, people whose suffering and courage can never be counted or repaid. I feel that day as I have on so many other days that I was simply the sum of all those African patriots. So it's a very important sentence he's making. He's telling, I'm just no one. The people, those who got the freedom, it's not that it's only because of me or it's one day. It is the sum total of many years of efforts and the efforts of many people, those many of those who have left or those who have lost their life. Okay. So that is what is Nelson Mandela today. If Nelson Mandela is a president, it is an efforts of many people putting together. That long and noble life ended and now began again with me. I was pained and I was not able to thank them, and that they were not able to see what their sacrifices had brought. In the word over here is wrought, that means brought, okay. So he says that I'm really thankful to those people, and I'm also sad that those people are not here today to see the reward of their hardship. Then further says, now again he is going to make a very important sentence. Now in this sentence, students, he is mentioning that the blacks, the people of South Africa, will not be able, though he is promising that in South Africa there will be no discrimination, but still he says that it will not be easy for the blacks to forget the atrocities, the cruelty, the brutality of the whites. It will take years for them to forget. It may not be generations, but definitely it is going to take years for them to forget. Then he further says that it is during this time of oppression, trouble and hardship that there were few great people, those who were created or born or came into forefront. So he names few of them like Oliver Tambo, Walter Sisulu, Chief Luther Lee, Yusuf Dadu, Braham Fisher and Robert Sobukwe. He says that these people were those people. He calls them men of courage, men of dignity, men highly respectable and highly regarded people. And he says that these people would have not been born. Not born, it's not been created, had South Africa not faced this hardship and this troubled time. So let's read this paragraph, students. I've already explained it before. The policy of apartheid created a deep and lasting wound in my country and my people. All of us will spend many years, if not generations, recovering from the profound hurt. But the decades of oppression and brutality had another unintended effect. And that was, it produced Oliver Tambo, as I had already mentioned you, the Walter Sisulu, the Chief Lutheli, the Yusuf Dadu, Ibrahim Fisher, and Robert Sobukwe. Men of such extraordinary courage, wisdom, and generosity that their life may never be born again or known again. Perhaps it requires such a depth of oppression to create such heights of character. My country is rich in minerals and gems that lie beneath its soil. But I have always known that its greatest wealth is its people, finer and truer than the purest one. This is the best sentence I like to use for any leader, a true leader. He says, yes, South Africa is a rich country. It is very rich in diamonds, in gemstones. But he says, my people are better. They are best even, they are best than even the purest diamond. So you see, in high regard, he is holding his people. The next paragraph, students, again is very important. A very important CBSE question comes from here for 2 marks. And this question is, what does courage mean to Mandela? So let's see, very nicely he's telling. He says, a brave person, a courageous person, is not a person who is not scared, is not a person who is not afraid. He also has fears, he is also scared, he is also afraid. But what makes him courageous? The thing is how he has learned to overcome his fear, how he has learned to deal with his fear, how he has learned to triumph, to get victory over his fear. Let's see what he says. It is from these comrades in the struggle that I learned the meaning of courage. Time and again, I have seen men and women risk and give their lives for an idea. I have seen men stand up to attacks and torture without breaking, showing a strength and resilience. Resilience is, students, the ability to deal with anything without losing hope, okay, and to recover from it. That defies the imagination. That is, without imagination, when they are tortured, but still when people come up, they stand up. That is what is resilience. I learned that courage was not the absence of fear. I repeat the sentence again. I learned, who learned? Mandela learned. That courage was not the absence of fear, but triumph over it. How to get over it. The brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear. So that is the bottom line or very important line of this paragraph and the answer to the question, what does courage mean to Mandela? The last paragraph of this part of the chapter, no one is born hating another person because of the color of his skin or his background or his religion. People must learn to hate, and if they can learn to hate, they can be taught to love, for love comes naturally to the human heart than its opposite. Even in the grimmest time in prison, when my comrades and I were pushed to our limits, I would see a glimmer of humanity in one of the guards, perhaps just for a second, but it was enough to reassure me and keep me going. Man's goodness is a flame that can be hidden but never extinguished. So students, here, Nelson Mandela, what Nelson Mandela is telling is that courage, I told you what he is meaning about the courage. So the next thing what he is telling is, he is telling that when he was in jail along with his people, so he is just reflecting upon two things, that is your love and hate. He says, yes, I have seen many people hating one another. Then he says that if people can be taught to hate, if people can learn to hate, then why is it that people cannot be taught to love, or why can't people learn how to love? Because love is a feeling which all human beings are born with. No one is born hating another. When a child is born, he or she doesn't know how to hate another. He or she is born only with one feeling, and that is love. So that is what he is telling, that when a person can learn to hate, why can't a person learn how to love? This is a very important sentence he is making. And then he further says, when he was in jail, and then they were, he and his comrades were pushed to limits. Limits means they were tortured, they were suffering, and they were pushed to the limits, unbearable. The things were unbearable for them. At that time also, he had seen the sparks of humanity in the hearts of the guards, those who were on duty in prison, though it was just for a small time or less, a few moments or seconds. But then he says that sparks of the humanity or goodness which he saw in the hearts of the guards over there, which made him believe. What was the belief? That goodness can never be extinguished. It can be hidden. It may be hidden, but this feeling can never go extinguished. That is what he is telling students. So based on these parts of this chapter, students, there are a few questions. I'll read out those questions, students, and most of the answers I've already discussed. Go through the questions, okay? Question number one, what do the military generals do? The military generals are saluting Nelson Mandela. How has their attitude changed and why? Their attitudes have changed because now they are showing their loyalty towards the newly elected government, President Nelson Mandela, and the country. Earlier, their loyalty was towards the whites. And why are they showing? Because obviously, South Africa is a free country. Second question, why were the two national anthems sung? Because Nelson Mandela said, even the whites are the citizens of free South Africa, and there will be no discrimination based on the color of the skin. Hence, there is two Nicosia, Skelele Africa, as well as the Dire Straits, both the national anthems were sung. Question number three, how does Nelson Mandela describe the system of government in his country in the first decade? There was racism, the rule of the whites over the blacks. Then, in the final decade of 20th century, this rule was overturned, South Africa became a free country, and there was no discrimination now. Question number four, what does courage mean to Mandela? I have already explained this this sentence, students. So he says, courage is overcoming fear, victory over fear. Because he believes a brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers the fear. The last question, students, which does he think is natural, to love or to hate? Obviously, to love, because this is the feeling with which we all are born with.
Start.
Well, students, that brings us to the last part of this extract from his autobiography. Whose autobiography? The Nelson Mandela. Okay? His autobiography, A Long Walk to Freedom. So, in this last part of this chapter, students, there are three things which are very important. Okay? So, number one is twin obligation. I repeat, twin obligation. Okay? The second, he is talking about freedom. What did freedom mean to Nelson Mandela as a child, as a student, and as a young man? Then, related with this freedom only, he decides to join ANC, that is African National Congress, in Johannesburg. And the last part, he mentions, is a little bit philosophical. Again, he is giving his quotes, we can see, he's saying. And then he says about that both the oppressed, which are the slaves, and the oppressor, the rulers. So both of them he calls that they are prisoners. Okay. So we'll discuss that about later on. So this twin obligation is a very important phrase, we can say. 2 marks question comes on this, and even the 8 marks question come on it. Okay. So let's see. Let's read. I'll read it first, and then I'll explain you all. Okay. Please pay attention. In life, every man has twin obligation. Obligation to his family, to his parents, to his wife and children. He has an obligation to his people, his community and his country. So this is what he is referring. What are the twin obligations? Twin obligations are nothing, but twin means two. Okay? Obligations are duties and responsibilities. So he is referring to the duties and the responsibilities towards two parts. What is the first part? The family. The second is the country. Society. So he further says, in civil and human society, each man is able to fulfill those obligations according to his own inclination and abilities. But in a country like South Africa, it was almost impossible for a man of my birth and color to to fulfill both of those obligations. This is in the common countries. Like in India, each of the Indian citizens, we also follow the twin obligations. We do have responsibilities and duties towards a country, towards a nation, towards a society, towards a people. The same way, at the same time, we also have responsibilities and duties and our responsibilities towards our own family members, that is our parents, our children, our brothers, our sisters. So we are able to do all those responsibilities without any problem. But then he says, in the country like South Africa, and a person like him means a person who is black, like Nelson Mandela, to perform this twin obligation is a big thing. He is not able to do so. In South Africa, a man of color means he is akin to the blacks, who attempted to live like a human being was punished and isolated. So this sentence is a self-explanatory. He says, a person who tries to live like a human being. So this sentence itself shows students that the blacks in South Africa were not treated like human beings. In South Africa, a man who tried to fulfill his duty to his people was inevitably ripped from his family and his home and was forced to live a life apart, a twilight existence of secrecy and rebellion. I did not in the beginning choose to place my people above my family, but in attempting to serve my people, I found that I was prevented from fulfilling my obligation as a son, a brother, a father and a husband. So in this paragraph, he's talking about twin obligation. Then he says that in South Africa, a person who tries to fulfill his duty is considered as a criminal, he's not allowed to do so. And that's a reason he is telling that in course of doing so, he had to live a life of secrecy and definitely he was, as he was doing so, he was not able to follow the law and had to break the law and was considered as a rebellion. So he finds students that in due course of time, first he never gave weightage or he never considered or he never gave priority to the nation or to his people. But in due course of the time, Nelson Mandela found that he started giving priority or the sufferings of his people, the nation or the blacks became his priority and his responsibilities towards his family took a setback or took a less priority in his life. So let's see further in the chapter. I was not born with a hunger to be free. This hunger for freedom is the second terminology in this part of the chapter 2, which is very important. So as he was born a child, he never understood what is freedom. Because whatever was he wanted was granted to him by his parents. So freedom was just the thing which was yes and no of his parents. The highest authority to him who was supposed to grant freedom was his parents. I was born free, free in every way. That I could know, free to run in the fields near my mother's hut, free to swim in the clear streams that ran through my village, free to roast mealies under the stars and ride the broad backs of slow-moving bulls. As long as I obeyed my father and abided by the customs of my tribe, I was not troubled by the law of man or woman. Very simply, very clearly, this paragraph indicates that as a child, his freedom was granted by the parents and he never understood what is the hunger of freedom and what is slavery means. So whenever he wanted to go and enjoy and run about in the field, he could do so. Near his mother's hut, whenever he wanted to swim in the stream, he could do so. Whenever he wanted to roast the millies, even at the night time, he could do so. Whenever he wanted to ride on the bulls, he could do so. No one was stopping him. He was supposed only to listen to his parents and obey the certain rules of his tribe. That's all. Now, the next part. It was only when I began to learn that my boyhood freedom was an illusion. So when he grew up, he was a young boy, then he realized that he is not free. All these illusions of freedom is all false. It's just a mirage. When I discovered as a young man that my freedom had already been taken from me, that I began to hunger for it. Now he is realizing what is freedom, and that hunger for freedom is growing. At first, as a student, I wanted freedom for myself, the transitory. Now he's talking about only the temporary, transitory, something, transitory word means temporary students. Transitory freedoms for being able to stay out at night, read what I please and go where I choose. So what were the freedoms he wanted? To read whatever he wanted, to go wherever he wanted, to stay out at night. Now these freedoms were not allowed to blacks in South Africa. Further he says, later as a young man in Johannesburg, I yearned. The word yearn means strong desire, strong want. I yearn for basic and honorable freedoms. Honorable freedoms is the basic things a human being is entitled to. Okay. So what he is telling? That he says that the basic and honorable freedoms of achieving my potential, of earning my keep. Potential and earning my keep means he wanted to choose a profession. He wanted to do the job of his will, of freedom. Then of marrying and having a family. You see the basic freedom. Basic freedom students means to do the job of the choice, to study the things of his choice, to carry on his life, like livelihood, then to marry, to have children, to have home. All these basic freedoms were denied to the blacks. Because we have already seen in the previous part of the chapter that the blacks were considered as human beings. Not human beings, I'm not saying human beings, but they were treated. They were not treated, in fact, like human beings. Hence, it is clearly mentioned that they were not entitled to any of the rights of human beings. Then, the freedom not to be obstructed in the lawful. So, since this shows that the rebellion in the young Nelson Mandela was coming up and his hunger for freedom was growing stronger and stronger. But then I slowly saw that not only was I not free, but my brothers and sisters were not free. I saw that it was not just my freedom that was curtailed, but the freedom of everyone who looked like I did. So he realized, when he looked around, he found it was not only he who was subjected to this kind of bondage or the lack of freedom or not restrictions basically. He found all the people around him, they're also subject to the same kind of restrictions. Basically, it was all blacks. It was then, this was a turning point. The realization that his entire race is subjected to this slavery or this restriction, this realization of this fact brought a turning point in the life of Nelson Mandela, and he decided to join African National Congress in Johannesburg. Okay? Now students, why did he decide? There's a question over here that as to why did he decide to join African National Congress, okay? Now he decided to join African National Congress because he very soon realized that if he has to fight for the men or the people of his country, the race of his country, the blacks of his country, he needs to go for a mass movement, and alone he cannot do. It has to be a mass support and the people, a mass movement, then only he will be able to win freedom for his country. So let's see what happens next. That is when I joined African National Congress, and that is when the hunger for my own freedom became the great hunger for the freedom of my people. 8 marks question comes from this sentence. How did, number one, how did his freedom, hunger for his own personal freedom, became hunger for the freedom of his people and country, and how did it prove to be a turning point in the story? It was that this desire for the freedom of my people to live with life, to live their lives with dignity and self-respect, that animated my life. Just like Nelson Mandela. The want, the desire that the entire community of black of South Africa should live with dignity, this was the feeling that changed the life of Nelson Mandela. Now what were changes brought? Were brought in the life of Nelson Mandela, students? I'll number them out. So you also need to write down and number them up in your notebook or whatever, so that these things can easily come in your answers. So number one, that transformed a frightened young man into a bold man. A man who was frightened, a scared man, normal man, he became a very bold man. Second, that drove a law-abiding attorney to become a criminal. So he was a lawyer, attorney, a law-abiding, obeying laws, respecting laws, attorney, into what? Into a criminal. Obviously, when he has stood up against the rulers, that is the whites, and fighting for the rights of the blacks, he is definitely not obeying the rules, and he is declared as a criminal. Number three, that turned the family-loving husband into a man without home. A person who was family loving person who used to love to stay at home, enjoy the time with his family, suddenly he found that he was a man without home, because obviously he had to go from one place to another in hiding and to fight for the cause of his people. Then number four, that forced life-loving man to live like a monk, where a person was fun-loving, life-loving, family-loving. Now the same person is forced to live a life of a monk, a very simple life, no home, wandering from one place to another, going to places in hiding so that he is not arrested, but fighting for a cause. What was the cause? The liberty, the freedom of his men and the country people. Then next he says, I am no more virtuous or self-sacrificing than the next man, but I found that I could not even enjoy the poor and limited freedoms I was allowed when I knew my people were not. The fifth point is telling that once he started raising his voice against the whites and asking for the freedom of the black, he was not even allowed the basic, very basic freedom which the other blacks were allowed. Then next he says, freedom is indivisible. The chains on any one of my people were the chains on all of them. The chains on all my people were the chains on. He says that freedom is indivisible. It cannot be that whites will get the freedom and the black will not get the freedom. No, no. It will not happen like this. The freedom is universal. He says all people, those who are born on this earth, are free. They have got right to live a free life. So that is what he says, that freedom cannot be indivisible. It is only that whites will only enjoy the freedom and black will not enjoy. This will not happen. Then he further says that even as long as there is even a single African who is in chain, that means Nelson Mandela is also in chain. And Nelson Mandela is going to fight for it. The last paragraph which I told you students, there were three parts in this portion. Number one was to an obligation, the second was hunger for freedom, and the third one was oppressed and oppressive. So the last paragraph of this extract from his autobiography, that is Long Walk to Freedom, Nelson Mandela is being little philosophical, and he is telling about, I knew that the oppressor must be liberated just as surely as the oppressed. Now you must, oppressor is the ruling party or the rulers, and oppressed are the slaves. Now you must be thinking that why do the rulers need to be free? They are automatically free. They are free. That's the reason they are the powerful. That's the reason they are ruling. Now why is Nelson Mandela telling that they need to be free? The students, Nelson Mandela here is mentioning that the rulers need to be free. Let's see why. A man who takes away another man's freedom is a prisoner of hatred. He is locked behind the bars of prejudice and narrow-mindedness. This is the answer. So what he is telling that the people, those who are ruling over another person, another human being, so those people are also the prisoners. Okay? Now what prisoners they are? They are the prisoners of hatred. They are behind the bars of prejudice and narrow-mindedness. This is what he is telling, that the people, that is oppressor or the rulers, also needs to be free. Free from number one, hatred, number two is prejudice, and number three is your narrow mindedness. Now let's proceed further. I am not truly free if I am taking away someone else's freedom, just as surely as I am not free when my freedom is taken from. He says, I am not a free man if I am making somebody else slave. At the same time, if I am being a slave of somebody, then also I am not a free. The last sentence he says, students, the oppressed and the oppressor alike are robbed of their humanity. So the last part of this chapter, students, he is telling that both the oppressor and the oppressed, both are robbed of the humanity. Obviously, the oppressed, the people, those who are slaved, they are treated worse than like the animals. They have no rights to live. We can very well understand they are the robbed of humanity. But even the oppressors, the rulers, since they are the prisoners of hatred, they are the prisoners of prejudice, they are the prisoners of narrow-mindedness, and because of this only they do cruel, they are being cruel, they are being brutal to the slaves or to the oppressed, hence they are also robbed of humanity. Okay, so students, this is the chapter. We have come to the end of the chapter, students. So all through the chapter I have been telling you the important questions, the 2 marks question, the 8 marks questions. So let's go through a few questions on this part. What twin obligation does Mandela mention? The twin obligations are nothing but the responsibilities towards the nation as well as to the family. Then what did being free mean to Mandela as a boy and as a student? How does he contrast these transitory freedoms, the temporary freedoms, with the basic and honorable freedoms? Then third question, does Mandela think the oppressor is free? Question mark. Why or why not? Obviously, oppressors are not free. They are business of hatred, prejudice and narrow-mindedness. There are a few more NCERT questions, students. The slide next will be showing you about these questions. You should answer all of them.